As promised last time, today let us discuss one interesting result due to Poincaré and another due to Munkres. First, let us take Poincaré's result. We will require two facts which we have not proved for lack of time. The first fact is, for any closed surface means compact surface without boundary, the Euler characteristic is always less than or equal to 2. Okay, you can assume compact without boundary and connected. Euler characteristic of that surface less than or equal to 2, and equality holds if and only if S is homeomorphic to S2. The second fact is, if M is compact odd dimension manifold, important, with non-empty boundary, then its Euler characteristic is half of the Euler characteristic of the boundary. So twice chi M is chi of boundary of M. The second fact is an easy consequence of the following fact, which is not an easy thing, namely, every odd dimensional closed manifold Euler characteristic is 0. From that you can deduce this one by our technique of doubling the manifold. So that is the hint, and I'll leave the rest of them to you as an exercise. The first fact you will see in the last part of all these lectures, this will be actually proved finally. Okay, so right now we have not proved it, we'll assume that. Okay, now let us look at this Poincaré's result. Take a simplicial complex which is a pseudo manifold of dimension 3 without boundary. And suppose it is obtained by identification of pairs of facets of a convex polyhedron P inside R3. Just like we have done in the previous theorem. If the Euler characteristic of this K, which is X, namely mod K is X, okay, Euler characteristic of this one is 0, then X is a closed 3 manifold. If it is a 3 manifold, its Euler characteristic must be 0. That's a general result. So Poincaré comes up with this great result of the converse kind of thing. Of course, you have to use that. It is a quotient of a convex polyhedron by identification on the boundary, right? So that is the hypothesis. Any pseudo manifold of dimension 3 is quotient in this way. That's what we have proved that theorem. Only then we have asked this question, and now Poincaré has an answer here, a very, very positive answer. The proof is not very difficult. Let us go through this one. We need to prove the local Euclideanness of X. There is nothing else. Okay. It's being compact and Hausdorff already. Okay, it's because it is going to be a modulus of the quotient of some identifying this one. Okay, simplicial complex. It is a simplicial complex. So local Euclideanness is what you have to show. For points which are images of points in the interior of P. On the interior of P, the quotient map capital theta is injective. It's a homeomorphism. From a convex polyhedron to interior of P. Therefore, there is no problem. Okay. Similarly, those points which are in the image of an interior of a facet. Facet is a two simplex now. Take a point in the interior of that facet. Relative in the interior, inside it itself, okay? Not in the interior of P. What happens? Whenever it's pseudo-manifold, right? Whenever you have a two simplex, it shares it's a facet of exactly two, three simplexes. One on this side, one on the other side. So union of two simplexes will be there. Taken union along the two simplex, three simplexes, right? Therefore, it is one half half open space on this side, half open space. Together, it will be the full open subset in R3. It will have a neighborhood like that. So there also there is no problem. Okay, so what are the points that are left out? Points on the edges. Both interior of an edge as well as finally the vertex points. So these are the points which have to be carefully studied. What happens to the neighborhood of these points? So consider a point in the interior of an edge. So these are two classes of the interior of an edge or vertex. Okay, first let us look at interior of an edge. The topology of the neighborhood of such a point depends on the topology of the link of A, because if you look at the star of E is a closed star of this E. E is an edge, E is a simplex, E is a one edge, right? One simplex. The star of E is link of E joined with E. Okay. E is what? E is homeomorphic to an edge, its interval. So there I know what is the topology. There is no problem. So what is link of A? This is the mystery. This I don't know how it looks like. If this is also like a ball, then you would have completed the proof, right? So what is this one? Is the topology of this one looks like? This is the neighborhood of after all. Star is the neighborhood. It looks like linky. So if I understand linky, then I know what is going to happen. Hence, star of E, the underlying topological space modulus of that is homeomorphic to the iterated cone. You see, this is an edge. Okay. So if you take one single star with one single point, it would be a cone. Right? The cone over the cone is precisely star of this one. Because there's an edge there. So you can think of this as a cone over the cone of the link of A. So clearly, the link of E is one-dimensional pseudo-manifold. Why? Because star of E is dimension 3. Link of E, whatever dimension, plus this one, okay, plus one, it should be the whole dimension. That is the equation. Right? So dimension of this one has to be 1. 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to 3. So that is why this is dimension is one dimension. So it is a one-dimensional simplicial complex. Right? So we have already classified one-dimensional manifold. So how does this one look like is a question. The one-dimensional pseudo-manifold it is, because it's a link of a star of something. Okay. So this is not very difficult to see. So it's a one-dimensional pseudo-manifold. There is no other choice. It has to be a manifold. Only thing is, if it is connected, then it will become a circle. The cone is already a disk. Cone over the disk is another disk. So that's the 3 disk. So you have found a neighborhood which is a 3 disk of every point inside E, in the interior of E. Okay. The only problem is, it may not be connected. If it's a connected pseudo manifold, one dimensional manifold, it has to be a circle. And that will complete the argument. So we must prove that the link of E is connected. So here is a picture. You want to say that this will not happen. This is our, the middle one is our one simplex. One of the one simplexes inside our K. It may happen that all these three simplexes are incident at this point, and they form two different groups. So one part is here going like this, another going like that. You don't know, they are not inside R3, you see. The quotient space need not be inside R3. So then what happens? The link would have been one circle here, one circle here. So why this picture is wrong? Why this picture doesn't occur? That one has to argue it. The only condition that we have is that chi of x is zero. From that, Payankar is able to reduce this one. So we will also see how he has done it. Okay. So we claim that it must be connected. So here it is a topological argument, not for chi at all. For if not, what happens? We can write link of E as A union disjoint union B. Okay, like this one. This is A, this is B. First of all, okay, as disjoint union of two subcomplexes. All right. We can then partition the set of identifications on the boundary of P into two sets accordingly, because what is the meaning of this link? Each edge here will determine, along with this edge, will determine a simplex. Okay, this edge star, this simplex will be a simplex there. And this one will be another simplex of simplex. So all these simplexes you place one way, all these simplexes you place another one. All right. So in P itself, you look for such a thing. Okay. You can see that identifications are taking place where? On the boundary pieces of this one. Okay. Therefore, no simplex in the first group will have anything to do with the second simplex. But they have one simplex common. How did that come? Remember, when you are identifying faces of F, automatically the edges will identify, corresponding edges will identify. Okay? But just some edge to edge, there is no identification. Extra identifications are not allowed. So this is very important note. Many people don't understand this one. When you identify a triangle with a triangle, automatically the boundary edges of this triangle and the boundary edges of that triangle are also identified in the corresponding order. After this, if you say this edge is identified with that edge, that is not allowed. Some isolated edge and edge identification is not done. Each edge identification is a consequence of the what? The two simplex identifications here on the boundary itself, not in the interior again. So this is what one has to understand. Therefore, this will give you a contradiction. Okay. There will be two edges left out, E1 and E2. Which are disjoint after you carry out all the face identifications But they are coming to same age here. So how did they come? So this is why the link of E must be connected pseudo one-dimensional complex. Therefore, it is a circle. Once that is a circle, star of E is the cone over the cone of that, which is three disk. Okay? So that will take care of all the points in the interior of all the edges. Finally, you are left with vertices. Why the neighborhoods of vertices are homeomorphic to R3 or homeomorphic to a disk D3? This is what we have to see. Okay? Once again, this is where the last condition chi x equal to 0 comes. Okay, it remains to check that local Euclideanness at the image VI of vertices of the boundary of P. In the interior, there is no problem. By passing to a subdivision of K, okay, we may assume that the star of VIs are disjoint in mod K equal to X. This is an easy thing because if you keep subdividing, at least actually second barycentric subdivision is useful here. First barycentric subdivision may not give you this one. Okay, by passing subdivision, you can make the vertices far away. The new vertices which you have come, they are not going to create problem because they will be inside edges or simplexes and so on. It is the old vertices of the original K we are worried about. Now those things, star of those little vertices will be disjoint in mod K. Okay. So you assume this one right in the beginning, which is not correct in general sense. Okay, mod K is the same, mod K prime, mod K, whatever you have subdivided, mod of that is the same thing as X. Okay, we need to show that each link of VI is a topological two sphere so that the cone over that is a disk. Now, E being a single point, link E starred with E is going to be the star of E, right? So that E is just a single point. So that's a cone. Okay. So all that I have to prove is link of VI is a topological two sphere, which is the same as showing that chi of the link is 2 for all I. This is where I am using the fact 1, fact A. Okay. So we are going to prove chi of VI is 2 for all of them, all I. So what do I do? Let S equal to union of star of VIs. This is a disjoint union by our assumption. And let L be the closure of K minus S. Okay, star of VI is a closed subset. So union of all these is a closed subset, it's a finite union. You take K minus S, that's an open set, you take the closure of that. So that K is actually L union S. Okay, and what is L intersection S? It is precisely the boundary of union of boundaries of all star of VIs, which is nothing but the links of VIs. It's a disjoint union of links of VIs. The star of VIs are themselves disjoint. So this also disjoint union of links. Okay. Then L is a topological three manifold. Okay. With boundary equal to, namely boundary of L, precisely equal to L intersection S. Why L is a topological three manifold? We have verified it because L is a complement of all these bad points. L is contained in the complement of all these bad points. So that's a topological manifold. Okay. L itself is what I have put here? Yeah, K minus S. Okay, K minus S, you apply K manifold, its boundary precisely L intersection S. Okay, this is an open subset. All right, so the boundary of L is L intersection S, the three manifold, and now I use the fact B. What does it say? Chi of boundary of L is equal to twice the chi of L, right? Chi of boundary of L is equal to twice the chi of L. But what is boundary of L? It's chi of S intersection S. Also, what we have, chi of X is zero. That is the starting hypothesis, which is same thing as chi of K, okay, a simplicial complex. Simply for a simplicial complex, what is the formula? This formula also you have seen. Chi of S, which is a subcomplex, plus chi of L minus chi of the intersection. Those which are added twice, both here, they have, you have been adding, so you have to subtract that. Okay? So suppose this is K, and this is what I have to, where I have taken K here. So I have to just put chi of L, okay, is chi of boundary of L, yes. What is S? Tell me, what is S? Chi of S. It is a disjoint union of what? See, what is this S I have put here? Star of VIs. Each star of VI is like a three disc. It is a, whatever it is. It is not three disc is our problem. But it is contractible. For a contractible space, Euler characteristic is 1. But there are, how many of them are there? K of them, let us say. That K is number of vertices there. Okay? So, Euler characteristic of a disjoint union is the sum of the Euler characteristics. Therefore, you get that K here. Okay? This minus this is half of this one, because this is, this itself is chi of L, half of chi of L. Chi of L is half of chi of boundary of that one. So this is K minus half of chi of S minus L. And that is zero. This just means that I into 1 to K, chi of LVIs is equal to 2K for the links. Notice that each LK of VI is a surface, and hence chi of link of VI is less than or equal to 2 by fact A. By the way, that the link is a surface, what surface? Pseudo-manifold, actually. It's the boundary of a nice manifold. See, we have seen that this is a boundary, it's a common boundary here. Okay. So this is equal to the union of links, disjoint union of this. This being so boundary components, so they are all surfaces, two-dimensional manifolds. And they themselves don't have boundary. So they are closed manifolds. Okay. Therefore, each of them, chi is less than or equal to 2. Okay. But the sum total is equal to 2k. Therefore, each of them must be equal to 2. There are k of them. Each of them is less than or equal to 2. The sum total is 2k. So, therefore, each of them must be equal to 2. It follows that each L of LK of VI is a 2 sphere for each I. So, let us now take a result due to Munkres, which is actually used in a big theorem by Stanley through another important person called Reisner. The Reisner gave a combinatorial condition for the face ring of a Cohen face ring to be a Cohen Macaulay face ring of a simplicial complex. Gave a topological condition. Munkre's result uses to prove that the Reisner's condition is satisfied in a particular way. Okay. So in that way, Munkre's result is useful in this combinatorics. So ultimately, all these things were used in proving a big conjecture in combinatorics, which is called the upper bound conjecture by Stanley. Okay, so we are not going to do anything about face rings and so on, but we will do the topological aspect of that, namely Munkre's result, which is an important result. But I want to show that just because something is important doesn't mean that proofs are difficult. I want to give you an easy proof of this one here. Okay, part of it we have already done. So what is the theorem of Munkre's? It says, take a connected topological space, which is triangulated, x is mod k. And I assuming that k is a finite simplicial complex of dimension n. Then the following two statements are equivalent. This is the theorem of Munkre's. What is that? It is some local homological condition. Hi twiddle of x is 0. This is a global condition. Hi twiddle of x minus x is 0 for I less than n, for every x in x. So this is true for I less than n. Both hi twiddle of x minus x and hi twiddle of x is 0. Course, you don't need to put a twiddle here. It's the first condition. Second condition is hi twiddle of the link of f is 0 for I less than dimension of the link of f and for every face of f, every face of k. For every face of k, the homology is 0 below the dimension. The reduced homology. Okay, so this is the condition, and these two conditions are equivalent in the statement of the theorem. Okay, since we have done a little bit of study of these things, it will be very easy for you to study, easy for you to follow this proof. Observe that since empty set is also a phase, okay, empty set is allowed to a phase. According to our convention, according to Munkre's convention, the link in K of the empty set is the whole of K by the very definition. Therefore, condition B implies, look at condition B for every, for I less than the dimension of link, is 0. The condition B put F equal to empty set. Hi of link of f is what? The whole k. Hi twiddle of k is f is 0. So this gives you the first part here. Okay? Just one single phase, f equal to empty set, gives you the first part here. So it remains to prove only this part from here to here. Of course, from here to here, you have to prove all this. Okay? So here to here, by taking f equal to empty set, this implies this, this part implies this part, first part. But for others, you have to wait for. Okay, condition B implies that is here for ILSN. We shall first prove two lemmas. I am breaking down the proof into simpler statements here. Okay, instead of complicating the whole proof in one go. Take just these conditions. Condition A and condition B. any one of them, you will get that K is a pure simplicial complex. A implies K is pure, B also implies K is pure. See, we have not yet proved that A implies B and B implies A, but either of them implies K is pure is a first step. And proof is similar to what we have seen for purity of a topological manifold, triangulated topological manifold, right? We have seen that one. So the proof is similar here. Suppose A holds. Take a maximal simplex inside K. I have to show that dimension of that simplex is equal to n. That's what I have to show. Purity means that. Okay. Take F to a maximal simplex. Take a point in the interior of F. Then hi of x, comma x minus x, we have seen is hi of dk, comma sk minus 1. These steps we have seen before. Okay, this is just excision. Okay, where this k is the dimension of f, star of f, etc. Okay, where f is a simplex of maximal dimension. That is why this works, because star of f will be open subset inside k, inside mod k. Therefore, if this is true, condition A implies that this k must be bigger than or equal to n. Hn of this one, we know, is equal to infinite cyclic. But the condition says that dimension, below the dimension, these are all zero. So this n, k must be bigger than or equal to n. But k cannot be bigger than or equal to, bigger than n. So it must be equal to n. Okay. Now condition B. Suppose condition B holds. Now this time the proof is a little more elaborate, and it is again repeating the old arguments here. Suppose K is not true. Suppose K is not pure. Let L1 be the collection of all n simplexes, okay, and their faces. If it is not pure, that means there are spaces which are of lower dimension things, maximal simplexes. Okay, take L2 to be the collection of all faces, simplexes F, which are not a face of any n simplex. Okay, so they will be of lower dimension and they are not faces of any simplex. You take that and take the collection of all that and their subspaces, and their faces and so on, namely the subcomplex generated by them. So you have two different subcomplexes here. The union is the whole of K. Okay, L1 and L2. So K is union of L1 and L2. And both L1 and L2 are non-empty is the assumption. K is of dimension n, so L1 is non-empty. It is not pure, so L2 is non-empty. Since X is connected, L1 intersection L2 must be non-empty. All these arguments you have seen earlier also. Okay. Take a maximal simplex inside this subcomplex, L1, L2. So sigma be the maximal simplex. Then, of course, sigma is non-empty. And it's a proper face of a simplex F in L2. Why? Because if it's a full simplex, then that full simplex will be a subcomplex of L1. L1, that means it will be contained inside a larger simplex. So it is not. Therefore, the intersection is a proper smaller than any simplex in L2, the largest simplex in L2, sigma. Okay. So then sigma is non-empty and is a proper space of a simplex F in L2. And hence, dimension of sigma is less than dimension of F. And dimension of F itself is less than N because F is inside L2. Okay? So the codimension from here to here is at least 2. N minus this one is at least 2. Okay. Also, sigma is a proper phase of an N simplex F prime in L1 because it's in the intersection L1, L1 intersection X2. Everything inside L1 will be contained in a larger simplex, which is N dimension. Okay. Hence, link of sigma intersects both L1 minus sigma and L2 minus sigma. Okay. Since sigma is maximal, this part of the proof is different from the old thing. There we used connectivity, blah, blah, blah. So here we are doing something different. Okay. The link of sigma itself intersects both L1 minus sigma and L2 minus sigma. Okay, since sigma is maximal in L1 to L2, it follows that link of sigma is disconnected. Therefore, H naught middle of sigma, L link of sigma is not zero. If it is zero, it would have been connected. This is the reduced homology. Okay, so it's not zero. But link of sigma we have just seen is dimension at most n minus 2. Right? This just now we have seen it here. At most dimension n minus 2. And sigma is inside F. Dimension of F prime is n. Dimension sigma inside. Sigma is contained in F prime is inside L1 and dimension of F prime is n. Therefore, dimension of the link of sigma is at least greater than or equal to 1. Below that, this must have been 0. That's a contradiction. This is not 0, that's a condition B. Okay, so this proves our lemma, namely, both conditions imply K is pure. Now, after this, the proof of Munkre's result is very easy. All that you have to observe is following. Observe that we have used only the second part of condition A and condition B only for non-empty phases of K in proving the purity. Okay, the empty phase is first part. So I have already told you this one. So now proof of 6.3. By our lemma, either of the conditions imply K is pure. Hence, each F belonging to K, the star of F has dimension must be n because it's pure. So dimension will be there all the time. Full dimension will be there, no matter whether you take a vertex or an edge or a two simplex and so on. Okay, so dimension of star is always n. Therefore, dimension of link of F plus dimension of F plus 1, which is equal to n. This is the dimension of the star. Okay? Because star is always link starred with link of F joined with F. So that's why dimension we have been using this one again and again. Now, start with condition A. I want to prove that it is equivalent to condition B. Okay? There are only these two steps now you have to understand. And that is the end of the proof. Okay, let us see. Condition A implies and implied by is equivalent to h I twiddle of x is 0 for I less than n. That is the first part. The second part is h I of x minus 1, x minus 0 is 0. So what we have seen that is equal to h twiddle of j of, sorry, h twiddle j of j minus dimension of f minus 1 of link of f. By taking a point x inside f for every f. Okay, so this is 0. This is follows from the second part here. For every non-empty phase f, because I have to take a point in the interior of that. Okay, so non-empty phase of K. And this j must be less than n. Then we have seen this proof, the hj of star of f minus star of f minus x, then from there we come to this one. Okay. Now take these two statements. For the first statement implies this one, h j tilde of x is 0 for I less than n. Okay, I have to put that. H j, j less than n, here I have put I. The second condition says h tilde of j minus n plus dimension of the link of f of this one is 0 for j less than n and for every phase f of k. We have just seen the link, dimension of the link. I am putting that here. Dimension of the link is n minus dimension of f minus 1. So you put that here, you get a j minus dimension of f is minus n plus dimension of 1 minus 1 cancels out. Okay, how I get it? I get it from here by 40. Okay. So from here to here to here you have come. But this is nothing but condition B. So Munkres theorem is proved also. Next time, we shall make some general remarks about triangulations. Where to find more material, what are general results known, and so on. No proofs. After that, we will start classification of triangulated surfaces. Thank you.